Thanks, Ariana, for the nice introduction. And now I just will go back to full screen again. Yeah, my talk is about our project OstData. In the end, I will start with a short introduction. I will introduce in the project context and give some overview of our goals, our objectives in the project, or what we would like to do with our legacy data, and then a short overview of the methodology, some implications, what you could do with this linked data, and so on. And our project context is mainly our joint project called OstData, which is about the establishment of a central service for research data in the field of East European studies. And until now, we focused more on the infrastructure part of the project. So when we wrote the abstract, we indeed started to prepare the legacy data, but then there were more focus on the infrastructure part. So we will see how far we got already with our legacy data preparation. And we also, it's the second project context, is our institutional research data repository called Lambda. And in the context of the OstData project, we will integrate our own research data, research data created at our institute. It will be published also in, not only in Lambda, but also integrated in OstData. And then we have a kind of information integration portal, which should provide a kind of institutional knowledge graph in the future, integrating all metadata from metadata about data sets, but also, of course, about documents, publications, and so on. That's the homepage of our institutional research data repository. And at the moment, it's a typical faceted navigation discovery system, and meant to discover data sets. And in the future, we think about to create some specific data set type, data type specific discovery systems in the future. For example, it could look like this GASSIS search discovery system, which is built to discover, to go deep into socioeconomic data, in this case, survey data, especially survey data. And that's another example of a more elaborated discovery system called Kiad Ring. And it has this interesting navigation system called knowledge organization system used, where you can find, for example, data sets which are classified or tagged with concepts from a specific knowledge organization system. And that slide will also be presented in the conclusion of my talk. And just a short remark, this was this hypertextual digital research environment imagined as a vision, developed as a vision by Ted Nelson in this hypertext research. And you can find all kind of things historian data types a historian uses in his research, for example, demography tables or census data, category systems or coding lists, coding schemes, and so on, or subject indexes, and so on, and of course, bibliography, and so on. And our objective is to somehow, so the main problem we see is that the main problem are incomplete or inaccurately prepared sources. And so you could also say it's a lack of adequately modeled research data. And the research question in our data preparation part of the project is how can a linked data technology be applied to make research data fair for research in digital history? And I would argue that the linked data paradigm provides a solution for source-oriented modeling, and also for integration of historical sources as research data. The linked data approach can especially be used for legacy historical census data and survey data, which must not really be historical. And We have a focus on interoperability, integration, and distribution of the verified data with historical maps and other resources like geospatial data and so on. And here's just the verification process, how it looks like. It's a FAIR website, and they also consider to use linked data for this process. I think I have to skip this historical part of the talk. Just to make it short, Leibniz introduced or invented a kind of linked data integration approach already in the early modern times. Of course, it's about official statistical data. And now I start with our methodology. And as I said, we in our OSTATA project, we focused more, until now, we focused more on the metadata part, so to speak. Not really so much as on the macro data or even micro data part. And so for the metadata, we developed a DCAT-based application profile, which is at the moment used only in our Lambda repository. So we use the well-known DCAT data catalog vocabulary, which has this basic distinction between data set and data distribution. And these are the main building blocks of our metadata schema, which is a kind of application profile, because we do pick the classes and elements not only from DCAT, but also from DISCO, the DDI RDF discovery vocabulary, and we need this DDI RDF as a DISCO vocabulary to describe methodological information, which are, you have no properties for that in DCAT. And it's mainly used to improve retrieval and used in discovery systems. And I think this is not the best diagram, but it should it shows an example. It's just an example here. On the left side, you have this so-called GREG georeferencing of ethnic groups dataset, which was not built by us, but by Weidmann and colleagues in 2010. And it's a kind of digital edition of the Soviet Atlas Narodov Mira, which contains very much maps with the territorial extents of ethnic groups. And we tried to create an kind of linked data version out of that, which uses well-known polygon coordinates in well-known text format. And for example, here's an information property DISCO collection mode from the DISCO vocabulary. And we use Tadira, for example, to annotate or to describe the collection mode, which was linked open data. So which means a process which creates linked open data out of CSV files, because here you have the distribution, the correct data, a CSV file, and here in the end you have this derived data distribution in RDF turtle format and so on. And that's just a look into the analog manifestation of the Atlas Narodov Mira. I had some problems to on our virtual machines. For some reasons, this linked open data for web feature service does not yet run again. And so I have just some polygons from the digitized analog atlas. But of course you could retrieve all these polygons and merge it as an overlay map with other maps and so on. And now we go from the metadata level, from the level of metadata to the level of microdata and macro data. And to model statistical data, we try to apply the RDF data cube vocabulary, which allows to publish, it's just from the a quote from the documentation, which allows to publish multidimensional data such as statistics on the web in such a way that it can be linked to related data sets and concepts. And the main tasks to use this data cube vocabulary is to model observations in census data, for example, which are in the end the measurements, for example, the account of population in a specific administrative unit or a level of administrative unit. And in addition to this cube vocabulary, we use DISCO again for some documentation tasks, for example, to document variables which you have in survey data, and also to model questions. So data collection instruments of survey data, so questionnaires. And it's again about improving the fairness of the data. I think I have also to skip this workflow, which looks a little bit more into the necessary tasks which you need if you integrate or aggregate statistical data from different sources, which is done, for example, quite often by our economists at our institute. We do not only have researchers in economy, but other way around. We do not have only researchers in the area of history, but also economists at our institute, which is quite interesting for interdisciplinary research, but also kind of difficult to, provide interdisciplinary knowledge organization for data and so on. And our goal would be, of course, similar like this very interesting Dutch SEDA project, where they integrated modeled all the Dutch historical census data in RDF Data Cube, and that looks like this. We have, for example, this typical dimensions of the data cube, sex or gender and age of persons and so on. And another dimension, which is also very typical, is the referred area. For example, here it's obviously about persons in Amsterdam. And so on. We have two kinds or two sets or two collections of legacy data. First, we have historical census data from our old project Ethnodoc, which was carried out by the Forschungsverbund Ost and Südosteuropa, called Vorost, at one of our predecessor institutes at the Südost Institute in Munich, and it's so to speak, delivers facts and figures about more than 40 minority groups in Southeast Europe. And in the end, you have a knowledge base and where coding of ethnic groups, language groups, and religious groups is done throughout the data. And we try to reuse, of course, this code list and models this code lists in data cube in SCOS, to use it in the data cube data. And the second collection is a collection of surveys which are about German Russian emigrants or immigrants from Russia to Germany. And so that is also an interesting use case, by the way, to create maps showing the places of origin of the people of the German Russians. And you can merge it with Atlas Narodov Miro, where you have the territorial extents of the now historical extents of the ethnic groups, which also includes German Russians, of course. And that's an example map from the Ethnodoc project. This is based on that data, typical kind of Excel engineering screenshots I have made here, and sets a more like typical historical census data, which can be modeled like that, following set pattern. You have also this quite interesting publication from 2019, where you find a lot of modeling examples using a cube data cube vocabulary. And here you have again, this data cube has three dimensions. So referred area here, this is Yugoslavia, the whole country. And you have another dimension, the time period. So it's the whole year 1948. And ethnicity is also a dimension, but it's not from SDMX, but it's defined for this specific historical census data from the Ethnodoc project. And it also uses a code list from Ethnodoc, and 34 is, I think it was, Montenegrina. Yeah? It means this ethnic group. And here you have the amount of persons, and here you have the amount of population in person, which you can find again here in the table. I have to look at, not to run out of time, I think. So I will skip this RDF data cubes in a nutshell. It's just a quote from, these are just quotes from the documentation. But just a detailed information about the data cube vocabulary. And here's the main modeling approach for the survey data, the second collection of research data. Of course, you have to model somehow the data set or the study, in that case, the U2 survey. And now it starts to become interesting because here you in DISCO, you can also model the structure of the questionnaire. Of course, it's just an excerpt of the whole questionnaire. And here you can also define the variables which must be linked somehow to, for example, these are about the English word deportation replacement place or replacement date of replacement, and here you have place of replacement, so to speak. It happened during the Second World War with the German Russians, of course, and so here this has to be linked somehow to a gazette here with all these locations in Russia. And here you have a list of questions, and as you may see, you will be able to use Sparkle queries to find specific queries which contain specific terms which may be interesting for your research.
Just one thing, Ingo, I don't think there might be a delay with the slides because I don't see any Sparkle queries in this. We just noticed there were some issues with the slides, so I don't know. But also to let you know that, yeah, you mm-hmm. passed a little bit 15 minutes, so if you can try and summarize, okay. That would be useful. Okay. Thanks.
As there were no Sparkle queries, just this RDF.
Now we see it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and here's a small example for a gazette here. And the point is, SCOS is not enough. It's too simple, a too simple knowledge organization system. We extended with XCOS to be able to model this classification levels, which are typical for classification systems used in statistical data. Here's our Cosmos browser, and here you have, for example, this gazette for surveys and this SDMX code lists and so on, or this DDI controlled vocabularies for the methodological information and so on. And implications, I think I will skip set. For example, you could do some interesting structural topic modeling approaches with free text answers and in questions in survey data, and you can also try to classify the questions somehow. And finally, I come to the conclusions. So as I said, we try to go from metadata to the data itself, and so we design this application profile. And then we use RDF data cube vocabulary to move from metadata to models, the data itself, so to speak. That means to provide the data distributions not only as old-fashioned CSV files or proprietary SPSS or data files, etc., but also to represent the data as linked data. And I already mentioned it, SCOS is not enough. It's too simple somehow to model classification systems used in statistics, so we use SCOS, where we have generic and partitive relations and so on, and you can also use SCOS XL as an extension to model labels as classes or instances of classes, and then you will be able, for example, to model some links between old new labels for places and old labels for places, for example, by a property called previous label. Now perhaps we can see that we can somehow interrelate subject indexes and model in detail demography tables and so on. And I cannot go into the details with this historical part of, and I think also verbalization perhaps could be an interesting point or topic for the discussion. And I will also skip this slide. And last but not least, we had already the knowledge organization aspect, but the knowledge representation aspect of all that would be to use somehow CDoc CRM, for example, a CRM Psi to model observation instead of RDF data cube and so on. And CRM Geo would be an interesting could be applied to model divergent polygons, for example, which you find in this map in a report about the Balkan Wars from 1940, where I could use CRM Geo, the class SP6 declarative place, to model this different perspectives on the territorial extents of ethnic groups in Macedonia in that example. So it's a view from the Bulgarian point of view and the Serbian point of view, which obviously is quite divergent. Yeah. So.